Bien, bonjour, bon après-midi à tous. Bienvenue après ce déjeuner dans cette salle pour donc ce panel sur l'euro avec trois intervenants. Je les présentais dans l'ordre dans lequel ils sont assis ici. Olivier Blanchard, donc, qui est maintenant au Peterson Institute, un titre, je ne me rappelle pas, senior, je ne sais pas, avec un name senior fellow. Après avoir été chief economist du FMI et professeur au MIT. Ashok Modi, qui a été un responsable très senior au Fonds monétaire international, qui a mené les négociations sur notamment le programme irlandais, qui est maintenant à Princeton et qui vient de publier un livre très épais, très bien documenté, vraiment un livre sur la crise de la zone euro, qui est à ce jour, je crois, le livre le plus complet analytiquement et qui remonte dans l'histoire sur les origines du projet et ses défaillances, puisque c'est un livre qui est très critique sur l'entreprise de l'euro, ou en tout cas sur un certain nombre d'hypothèses qui étaient à sa base et qui étaient des hypothèses qu'il juge aventureuses. Enfin, Jean-Claude Trichet, que je n'ai vraiment pas besoin de présenter, mais on est très heureux qu'il soit là, puisque dans cette entreprise de l'euro, je crois qu'on peut dire qu'il a vécu absolument toutes les étapes. Quand je dis il a vécu, c'est un petit peu insuffisant, un petit peu dépréciateur, puisqu'il a été non seulement à l'origine, mais aussi ensuite un acteur absolument majeur de cette aventure, et donc qui va également contribuer à ce panel. Je vais peut-être passer à l'anglais, puisque Ashok Modi ne parlant pas français, on est convenu de faire le panel en anglais. Et donc, pour engager la discussion sur le fond, so it's the 11th World Policy Conference. I don't know how many times there were panels about the euro, but we are in 2018, certainly for 7 or 8 years at least, there have been panels of this sort. Why are we coming back to this issue? Perhaps one reason, to link what we will be discussing to what was discussed in previous sessions, and also it's not going to be the focus of what we are going to be discussing, is what does it take to be a fully fledged international currency? And is the euro such a currency? Does it have a chance to be such a currency? I think that's an important dimension of the project and something we may wish to go back at some point to. The second reason is that we still have discussions going on euro reform. There were initiatives taken, especially there were French initiatives recently. There is a completion of the discussion and the negotiation undertaken on banking union. So all that is not yet done. And the question is, what should be the priorities? And the third reason, and not the least, is that we are facing a new situation in Italy. Not so much about the sort of short-term dispute between the Italian government and the EU about the budget, but so more fundamentally about how Italy has fared in the euro area, what should be the options for Italy, what the way in which an economy like Italy can recover inside, or some would say outside the euro area. So though there are reasons for having this debate, let me say a few words on the nature of the discussion we are having and the issue of the priorities. On the nature of the discussion, there are essentially three camps, and they have been there for quite some time. I think they're still there. One that says it was a bad idea in the first place. European countries were not, in fact, sufficiently integrated, sufficiently similar to form a currency union. So this is a debate that started with the very first day of the project, and it's still, in a way, going on. The second view is that the architecture is incomplete, so that it was a project sort of half-backed because some steps were taken, but some important steps were not taken. And the question then becomes, what are the missing elements that need to be added so that the euro becomes much more resilient and much more able to deliver prosperity? And the third is that the design was good, but the behavior was bad, so that policies did not follow what should have been followed after having joined a common currency. So that it's more a matter of having the right policies at home, the question perhaps becoming then, what are the incentives to put those policies in place? Now, as regard the priorities, and I will end with that, again, there are different views, and I think we are depending on the analysis that is made of the situation. One view is that essentially the priority should be financial, that financial integration that was definitely incomplete at the start of the euro, that was a neglected part, especially everything that had to do with the supervision and the resolution of banking crisis. This should still be the priority, and that completing the financial integration, the policy integration of the financial side, I should say so, remains a top priority. The second view is that it is a fiscal element that's missing. So a budget, a fiscal capacity, you can name it the way you want, for reasons having to do with stabilization, for reasons having to do with the possibility of having an instrument that would complement the common monetary policy, and for reasons having to do with transfers. So that's also a sort of long-standing view that what's missing is the fiscal side. We should not forget a third element, which is the macro side, that we have the fast-moving issues and the sort of slow-moving dimensions. The slow-moving dimensions, that's price and wage adjustment, that the build-up of current account imbalances, that the resulting assets and liabilities, net foreign asset positions, and that this is this macro functioning that has to be reformed. That brings us into a different territory having to do with wage and price formation in different countries. So the institutions that contribute to wage setting and price setting, perhaps also to investment. And finally, and I should mention that also, is the view that the issue is fundamentally political, and that what we have to address in the current political context are the political institutions that the Eurozone doesn't have, is not equipped with, and what are the political dimensions of the problem we're facing, and what are the political responses to the problem we're facing. That's a very long agenda, but let me stop here. I'm sure we're going to address some parts of it, so we're going to skip large parts of it, and each of you will speak for 7-8 minutes. Then we'll have a moment of debate, and then I'll open the floor to the questions. Ashok, we agreed that you would start.
Thank you, Jean. You are able to hear me? Yeah, okay, great. I think I have a presentation. So since I'm the most controversial person on this panel, I like to show some pictures, otherwise the facts are contested. So this is the only slide on which I have words. The rest are all pictures. And the main point of this slide is that the warnings came very early in March 1971, very soon after the original proposal on monetary union was made in October 1970. And Nicholas Calder, who was one of the great economists of the 20th century, was the first to say that the single currency would amplify economic divergence. It's a simple economics is that a single monetary policy will be too tight for some countries, too weak for some countries, the weaker countries will be further set back, and the stronger countries will have added benefit, therefore the divergence will increase. there was a statement at that time that, well, that's fine, the architecture is incomplete, but eventually we will form a political union and we will create fiscal transfers of the type that you have in the United States, where the state of Connecticut transfers funds to the state of Alabama. Similar things would happen. Calder said, I doubt if that's going to ever happen, because it would require permanent transfers, not just temporary transfers. And he said, on the other hand, what I do expect, that the economic divergences will deepen political divisions, and a house divided against itself cannot stand. This is in March 1971. Robert Marjolaine, through the rest of the 70s, Robert Marjolaine is a name known to this audience, one of the great bureaucrats of the post-war era, a key catalyst of the Treaty of Rome. He was very opposed, dead opposed to the monetary union, because, and he gave the reason, he said the nation state is still alive. And he said that because the nation state is still alive, the idea that there will be compromises that will allow the creation of some kind of political structure within which the compromises can be made and a political union can be created, he said, was simply not going to happen, and therefore he opposed the monetary union, even though he was a very deep pro-European. And indeed, the rest is basically, the story is that Calder's ghost and Marjolaine's ghost have been since stalking the Eurozone. So you see that this great divergence that occurs. The Italian per capita income today is marginally lower than it was in 1999 at the time of the start of the monetary union. France, since the start of the crisis in 2008, has barely grown, whereas Germany has continued to grow. At critical junctures, this is exactly what Calder had predicted, that the divergence will increase. Because the divergence has increased, Germany is trading less with France and Italy, that were its principal trading partners in the, at the time of the euro. Germany has increased its trade, especially with China, but also with non-euro European countries like the Czech Republic, Hungary, and Poland. This undercuts one of the fundamental premises that the euro will increase trade between Eurozone countries and therefore will be a spur for growth. So it undercuts the essential argument that the euro does something good in terms of the growth effects. The risks, however, remain profound. So you see the Italian situation, the Italian per capita income has fallen. Young college-educated Italians are leaving Italy in growing numbers. Because young educated Italians are leaving, that further reinforces Italy's low growth trap. Calder's political forecast is also coming correct, that the economic divergence will then deepen the political divisions. You see that loss of trust in Italy is greater than in France and greater than in Germany. In 2012, in the crucible of the crisis, you had the formation of the AfD party, the Alternative for Deutschland party in Germany, and the Five Star Movement in Italy. They were an exact consequence of the political divisions. AfD felt Chancellor Merkel is doing too much for Europe. Five Star felt that Chancellor Merkel is dictating to Europe. Looking ahead, my theme is that the European Central Bank has reached the political limits of its actions and therefore is rapidly losing credibility. We saw that for the first time in 2012 and 13, when the Eurozone was descending into what people call lowflation or deflationary tendencies. Normally inflation, low inflation is considered good, but when inflation becomes too low, there is a worry that people anticipating the low inflation will tend to postpone their consumption, which will reduce growth, which will then make debt burdens harder to bear. The Americans were much quicker, and so you see the divergence. You see in the red line is the Eurozone, which is stuck at 1%. Within that, Germany is 1.6, and Italy is even lower. The European Central Bank continues to predict inflation will go up. Those are the dotted lines. The hard line is the actual inflation. So the credibility the between the actions and what it delivers remains very vast. In the next few months, we may well have a crisis. You see, Italian growth is rapidly slowing. That is the green line. As world trade slows, European countries slow, Italian slowdown is most pronounced. Italian interest rates are rising rapidly. Italian bank stock prices are falling. The combination of weak growth, rising interest rates, falling stock prices is a potent combination that could push Italy into an unmanageable crisis. There always remains the hope of a savior. And when Macron became president in 2017, he was quickly anointed savior. But here is where Marjolaine's ghost continues to stalk. Sovereignty barrier is stronger than ever before. The divergence between France and Germany remains important. The last time a French initiative led to a constructive European political outcome was in May 1950, at the time of the Schuman Declaration. Since then, the interests have diverged and the ability to come together has been extraordinarily difficult. So I end there to say that the euro has been a source of division and will continue to be a source of division, because the interests are naturally are different. The incentives to what Jean calls completion of the architecture will always be stymied. There will be technocratic solutions which will lack political legitimacy, and because they will lack political legitimacy, there will be either half measures or, in the worst circumstance, they will fail when they are most needed. So I stop there, and Jean-Claude can say why I'm completely wrong.
Well, for sure. But before that, let me ask you one question. Why do you ascribe the difficulties in Italy to the euro?
No, so I'm glad you asked me that question. I do not do that. What I say is that a weak country will be in a disadvantage in a single monetary in a zone that has a single monetary policy.
Well, you mentioned Kaldor, who said that.
Yes.
And you sort of used it as a basis, and
yes,
then you presented the evidence suggesting that the euro one was one of the reasons, or the reason why
what
Italy
I
has weakened.
What I say is that the Italian problems are Italy's problems. That the fact that Italy cannot generate productivity growth is an Italian problem. But the fact that it cannot devalue its currency is a eurozone problem. And when you bring the two together, a country that has negative productivity growth and cannot devalue, then you have an Italian problem. That is the point I'm making.
Okay. Jean-Claude.
I think we will go back to Italy probably, because it's a very important point. Of course, 8 minutes, something like that,
is
a very short, and I will try to be as rapid as possible. First of all, we are speaking of a long-term historic strategic project. The euro area is part of the project. It's in certain aspect, in economic, monetary, and financial dimension, the vanguard of the project at a certain moment. But the project itself is a very long term, started, like Ashoka said, in 50, if I take the Schuman speech, 68 years. And to judge, to make an assessment of such a long term historic project, one has to take a little time. Like Xuan Lai, when asked what he thought of the French Revolution, saying, well, maybe it's a little bit too early to judge. So I will be very positive, and I think that I can prove my points. First of all, when we started the euro, skepticism was absolutely generalized. Had we had a conversation on that, I would have been told, when you merge the escudo, the drachma, very soon, the peseta and the lira, with good currencies, you cannot get a good currency. So that currency will necessarily be non-credible internationally and non-credible domestically. I don't want to stress too much the thing, but we delivered stability internationally. The euro is approximately the same level vis-à-vis the dollar that at the moment of its start. The domestic stability has been ensured. When I was myself president, and when my predecessor was president, the main criticism in Europe was you will not deliver price stability. And it was a very strong belief, by the way, not only externally, but also in Europe, that we would not deliver price stability. We delivered price stability. Nobody is challenging now that the euro exists, that the euro is a credible currency, maybe too credible at a certain moment. I was accused myself of having too credible a currency, and that the price stability was ensured. So we have already that in the past. But for me, for my predecessor, and for my successor, it was still very, very challenging and demanding attitude coming crucially, I have to say, as regards domestic stability, from a large element, large fraction of public opinion in Europe. Second, resilience. We are speaking very negatively from time to time on a concept, the euro area, for the currency. I already said that it proved resilience in the worst financial circumstances since World War II, could have been the worst financial circumstances since World War I. And what happened to the currency? As I already said, it held and remained credible. What happened to the euro area? We were 15 countries in the euro area on September 15 when we had the collapse of Lehman Brothers. The 15 countries are still there for a concept which was prone to exploding. And I was told that by many of my friends in New York and Washington. Clearly, it's quite a success that all countries remain. But four new countries came in after Lehman Brothers, as you know. So we are 19 today and not 15. So more than one-fourth more countries are in the concept. I don't insist on that, but it's probable that nobody in the room or very few persons in the room knew that we had four new countries coming in after Lehman Brothers, after the drama at the global level started. Popular support. We were told that there was no popular support for the euro, or that the division were augmenting considerably. I'm sorry to say that it's not the case at all, at least according to the survey that are public and the Eurobarometer in particular, which is public. At the question, do you tend to trust the European Union, in the last survey published, 42% of the European Union responded, yes, we trust. And they were only 34% for the national institutions. So the frustration of our people, the frustration of the so-called populist move, which of course is hitting all advanced economy, is hitting more the national institutions, national governments and parliament than the European institution. It is never said. As regards the 10 not to trust, it's even more striking. It is 61% 10 not to trust the national institutions, and only 48, if I may. That is not very flattering. It's not flattering at all for the national institutions, not flattering for Europe and the European institution. Still, it is not rejection of the euro. And of course, I could not explain myself the resilience of the currency and the resilience of the concept of the euro area if there were not a strong popular support. As regards the euro, the popular support is even more striking. There is the same question which is asked by the Eurobarometer. Do you approve or disapprove the sentence, a European EMU which with one single currency in the area, the euro? The response is 74% against 20% approve. In Germany, 83%, when a lot of my friends on the other side of the Atlantic were telling me the Germans are only waiting for leaving the euro because of the Greek. In Greece also, it is a very high level. It's approximately 70%, 69. Even in Italy, which we mentioned, we will discuss Italy again, 61 vis-à-vis 29. So a very strong popular support, contrary to, I would say, common wisdom. Now, economic success or not? Then I have to say, I refer to the IMF data mapper, GDP per capita current prices. Since the beginning of the euro, the standard of living per capita, I mean the GDP per capita in Europe, grew more or less as fast as in the US. It's not very flattering because we should catch up the United States of America. But the common wisdom being that we are doing very, very poorly, I would like to mention that also en passant, I could also elaborate, but maybe I have no sufficient time, that we did better than the UK, which is very often, I would say, presented as being very happy out of the euro area. The catching up process is operating. And as regards divergences inside the euro area, again, I will go back to a very good analysis made by the IMF, which is much more nuanced, of course, than what Ashoka said, taking into account the fact that on some criteria there has been some convergence, on other criteria, no, there is no real convergence which would be visible. But we have to compare that also, perhaps, to the expectations. It's true that it was said the euro will permit to operate a formidable rapprochement between the various countries member, including in terms of GDP per capita. I think it was overdone, personally. And I take the example of the United States. In the United States, the Mississippi is more lower than Massachusetts in terms of GDP per capita than Portugal and Greece vis-à-vis Germany. So it is true that even in a single currency area, by the way, in the case of the US, a 200-year single currency area, the idea that by construction you necessarily have the equalization of the standard of living is naive. And of course, you get the equalization if you have very good governance at national level, which was not the case, obviously, and very good governance at the European single currency level. That being said, and I will conclude on that, we were not passive in the circumstances. We engage in major structural changes under the heat of the crisis, not before, I fully agree with Ashoka, but in the heat of the crisis, we created the banking union, we created the so-called macroeconomic imbalance procedure, which was overdue. We reinforced the stability growth pact with the fiscal compact. But to conclude, my dear President, we really did a lot, and a lot has to be achieved in this domain and in many others. I was myself the first, I think, to call for a Minister of Finance of the euro area. I think that we need much more democratic legitimacies in the euro area, with the European Parliament in the euro area format having the last word on some very important points, including disagreement between one particular country and the European institutions. And I take it that a budget could play also a role, also considering that vis-à-vis the United States, what is lacking in Europe is the absence of full-fledged banking union and full-fledged capital union, because it plays a more important role in the US in terms of transfers and, I would say, stability under asymmetric shocks than the fiscal channel itself.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, that's clear. So we had the sort of two views, quite different. Olivier, you're not a centrist, but your role is to sort of...
Yeah, exactly. I find myself, not surprisingly, in between. There's a lot of space between the two, so it's easy to be in between. I think the euro has real problems that Jean-Claude did not emphasize, that Ashok overemphasized. I think they can be alleviated. I don't think they can be eliminated. I've organized my remarks in 7 points. I'll try to stick to that. So the first one is, remember the remark about the democracy being the best of all bad systems. I think it's the same thing for the euro. I think that for the countries, at least for most of the members, maybe not all, the euro is the least bad of the monetary and exchange rate arrangements. Again, maybe as a footnote, maybe some members might be better off out, but let's leave this aside. The reason I say this is that we tried other ways before. We tried the soft peg, we tried the hard peg, it didn't work so good. So what's left is floating, which would be difficult to manage given the depth of the financial market, and I think that floating between Germany and France is a non-starter at this point. I just don't see it. So it seems to me we have to accept the fact that there is no good or perfect monetary system our exchange rate arrangement, but this is probably the best we can get. So we better make the best of it. So, second point. So what is it that I think doesn't work very well? Why is it that the euro is not functioning perfectly? It's due to the original sin, and Ashok mentioned that, and Mondale gave conditions for an optimal currency area, and it's fairly clear that on its face, the euro just did not satisfy those conditions, right? So either you need all the countries to have the same shocks, which we found that is not the case, or you need a lot of mobility of factors so that when one country does poorly, people move to the other, and there are limits to this when people don't speak the same language. And so the only thing which is left is that when you have a shock, you have to have an adjustment of competitiveness, you have to have an adjustment of relative prices. And that is what is not working well. When Ashok refers to the inability of Italy to depreciate, it could in principle do it at a fixed exchange rate within the euro, but it would have to decrease prices and wages. And that's what's not happening. So I think that's the source of the problem. Again, Europe has many other problems, and they interact with this, but this one is, I think, the implication of the euro itself. So the third point is, why is it so bad? Well, we know, and we've seen it now. We've seen it in two ways. First, we saw the very large current account deficits of the countries in the south, be it Greece, be it Portugal, be it Spain, and how dangerous it was, both because it would come to an end naturally or it could create a sudden stop, and we saw that. So we saw that when you cannot adjust your relative price and you run very large current account deficits, then you run into trouble. Now we're seeing the opposite. We're seeing basically an enormous German current account surplus. Now it's a bit of a different beast because you can sustain the surplus more or less forever, but it is not a good idea from your point of view, but it is something which affects the others. And basically, other things equal, the current account surplus of Germany is leading to a euro appreciation, which is clearly affecting other countries, and has all kinds of other effects, which I will not discuss. So the lack of adjustment of prices and wages has major implications. As I said, we know these implications can basically determine politics, and we're seeing this. So the question is, what is it? So if we take this as the issue, why is it that the adjustment is so low, so slow, so difficult? And so that's my fourth point, which is very short. I think there are two reasons. The first one is that not all countries play by the rules. And I'll come back to Germany. I think it is not playing by the rules of the euro, and that's an important point. Then the other is, even when they play by the rules, you have a very slow response of prices and wages to the labor market, and as a result, you have a long period, in the case of current account deficits, of high unemployment, and that, again, politically, humanly, politically, it is very costly. So let me now turn to rules and then to the slow response. So rules is my fifth point. What are the rules? The rules of the game is that countries which have current account surpluses should basically have prices increase faster than the average, so they should have more inflation than the average. And if they refuse to do that, either for contractionary fiscal policy or other means, then the other countries cannot adjust. And that's exactly what we're seeing in Germany, where you have contractionary fiscal policy limiting the amount of inflation and making the adjustment impossible. This is not respecting the rules. I mean, if somebody needs to decrease their prices below the others have to accept a higher price than the average. So I think that that is a big issue, and that's something which should be addressed and can be addressed under the existing institutions. But Germany has to understand that what is good for the euro, and is actually good for Germany, should be allowed to happen. So higher inflation in Germany is both for Germany and for the euro essential. On the slow response of wages and prices, I have about 1 or 2 minutes. I think there are two reasons. The first one is when the average inflation rate in the euro is low and you need to have less inflation in order to improve, it's very difficult. You may have to have cuts in wages, nominal wages, and this is extremely difficult to achieve. People do not like cuts in wages, and indeed you see that it doesn't happen, so you don't get the adjustment. So that's an issue for the ECB. The second, which is something that I care very much about at this point, is the lack of trust between social partners in many countries. In many countries, what's needed is a decrease in wages and prices, which would lead to a very small decrease in real wages, some but not much. It could be achieved if the partners understood without the unemployment. They do not agree, and as a result, what happens is you have a long period of unemployment which forces the same outcome, but with 5 or 10 years of hardship. And here it seems to me that that's at the level of countries, I'm thinking of my own, in France, the level of discussions between the social partners is extremely poor. It used to be much better under indicative planning in the old days, where the partners would sit down and see what could be done, and then they agreed, or they did not agree, but at least they discussed the issues. It's not happening. So I just conclude, what would I do? Higher inflation at the euro level. I would love more than 2%, but I accept 2%. I want 2% at least. Respect for the rules in the case of Germany and the other countries, but Germany in this case. Improvement in labor relations, which is a national issue. Let me end there and mention one issue I did not discuss, because I do not think it's an essential reform, is fiscal union. I fully agree with Jean-Claude about the banking union, capital markets union, but I don't think the fiscal union is an essential part of the solution.
Good. Thank you, and thanks for sticking to the time to all three. I'd like to go back to three topics. You just added a fourth one with fiscal policy, but let's start with the three. Before opening the floor. The first is this issue of the competitiveness wage price adjustment. I mean, you all three agree on the diagnosis that this part of the functioning of the euro area is not satisfactory.
Was not.
Sorry?
Was not.
Well, I mean, some adjustment took place, but
not.
The adjustment is still, it's perhaps faster than some would have expected. I mean, Ireland had adjusted extremely well. Even Greece is adjusting. Portugal is adjusting. So, you know, it's taking place, but it's taking place in a slow way and in a partial way. And this is something that was not sufficiently present at the start, was not sufficiently addressed in the reforms. And you mentioned the excessive imbalance procedure. It's not implemented.
Pardon?
It's not implemented. Germany has had
asymmetrically implemented.
Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to be implemented.
Right.
It was supposed to be symmetric. It was never, the procedure was never activated. So the macro side remains neglected. So I think that's one point on which you agree. Now, one of the recommendations of Olivier is saying we can do better by having a higher inflation rate, so achieving 2% really, and that means in this current situation, taking the risk of being a little bit above 2%, you know, but the risk of having too low inflation is very detrimental to the euro area, that's what you're saying. And second, that means, you know, all this much more institutional approach to the wage price setting and the social partners that you mentioned. Can I have some reaction from you on this topic?
Yeah, I can give you very quick reactions. Number one, inflation is stuck at 1%. In Italy, it is about 0.6%. And we're talking about higher inflation in Germany. The ECB has essentially lost credibility as an inflation-fighting machine. And therefore, there has been a disengagement between price-setting behavior and monetary policy. This is like the Bank of Japan. Essentially, you have the same problem here. The Bank of Japan keeps trying to introduce a stimulative monetary policy. Inflation does not budge because the relationship between how people set prices and how inflation is gets and how what the monetary policy does, there's no connection. On adjustment through wages, the main problem through adjustment through wages is social. You know, in my book, I tell a story about a woman who is a worker in a factory in Ivrea. And her income has gone down from 1,000 euros a month to 600 euros a month. And she says, if you cut it anymore, I won't be able to pay my mortgage. And the social cost, the social discontent that is created through this process is enormous. That is why people have floating exchange rates. The rest of the world has floating exchange rates for a very good reason. Because it is, creates an easy adjustment process. The adjustment through wages is almost never possible. Therefore, the idea, and this is, you know, coming back to a statement that Olivia, you made, that a floating exchange rate was a non-starter, or, I mean, it's a non-starter today, I understand that, but was a non-starter. I don't buy that. I simply don't buy that. Between, and Jean-Claude will remember this, from the time of the breakdown of the ERM to the time of the introduction of the euro was a period of 7 years. Essentially, exchange rates were in effect floating. He was making sure that the exchange rate remained close to what it was for Germany, but that was a policy choice. There was no commitment. And that's the crucial point about fixed exchange rate. There was no commitment to a fixed exchange rate, which allows the possibility that if there is a crisis, there will be an adjustment through the exchange rate. That possibility was essentially removed. And if that possibility is removed, adjustment through wages is never going to happen.
Jean-Claude, particularly on this issue also of the inflationary machine, as Ashok was saying about the ECB, the possibility of generating inflation on target.
Well, as you know, it's a problem for all major central banks of the advanced economy. So I will go there. First of all, I would like to go to the point which was made by Olivier. It is absolutely clear that rules were not respected. My first speech, myself, just appointed president of the ECB, was to tell Germany and France in the European Parliament, by the way, under the presidency of Italy, that it was a pity to refuse that the Stability and Growth Pact rules would be applied to Germany and France. Jacques Chirac and Chancellor Schröder were on the same line. And of course, they were backed by Italy. It's been a pity, not especially for Germany, probably for France, and of course for Greece and for Portugal and for Spain in some respect, that considered that the Stability and Growth Pact had not necessarily to be respected. A second experience I could mention was that since 2005, looking at the persistent divergences that we were observing in cost competitiveness and external imbalances, I was circulating every month to all ministers of finance of the euro area the divergences that were going on
and on and on.
Since the start of the euro, until 2009, namely after the financial crisis. The only way to block that phenomenon had been objectively the financial crisis. They were all aware of that. They were all aware of the fact that it was possible in this currency area to have the wages and salaries in the public sector in Greece to augment by 117% from the beginning up to end of 9, when it was 110 in Ireland, 70% in Portugal, and 36 in the average of the euro area, when it was 20 in Germany. So the possibility...
Aren't you lending support to Ashok?
Of course.
It was clear
since 2005 that we needed a very strong governance at the level of the center in order to do what Olivier was calling for, which has been done in the heat of the crisis with the obligation for a number of countries to go back to something which was more normal. And they are all, by the way, in current account surplus now, and an enormous, I would say, hard way. But how could it be anything but hard when you have distributed currencies in the same, euro area currencies, that is, an international currency of great value, by 117%. In Greece, it was obvious that the adjustment would be very, very painful. But all that being said, we are supposed now to be in a different world. And I fully agree with Olivier that the macroeconomic imbalance procedure has to be applied symmetrically. And of course, maybe a number of observers were too optimistic in thinking that Germany, in a overheating situation, would go back to the average yearly inflation that it had observed in the past. before the euro, 40 years before the euro, Germany had a yearly inflation of 2.93%. It is what we need now, clearly. If we want the 2% to be respected at the level of the euro area as a whole, we need a number of countries. The cases in point are clearly Germany and the Netherlands, a little bit perhaps Austria, and others below the average in order to catch up with their last competitive cost competitiveness inside the setup of the euro area. So, but let's not forget, the MIP has been created. So the criticism is that it is not applied as it should, and I fully agree with Olivier, but let's not say that we did nothing in the circumstances. And I was calling for that, you know, since the very first observation that there was no spontaneous correction of these persistent divergences.
We should save a little bit of time to speak of Italy.
Of course.
I thought Jean-Claude said something very unfair. And I think Jean-Claude is not in a position to actually contradict him. He said the ECB has lost all credibility because inflation is less than 2%. We understand the problems of central banks. The ECB is not the only central bank to have been unable to increase demand sufficiently to achieve inflation. Has done more or less everything it could. That was just not enough. Same thing has been true in the US. It has taken a long time to get back to 2%. So the notion that the ECB has lost credibility. No, I'm happy to say this because I've criticized the ECB enough in the past to have credibility.
There's a huge difference between the Fed and the ECB.
I appreciate very much what you said. By the way, since the very beginning, we delivered 1.75% for a central bank who we said at the very beginning it will be less than 2 but close to 2. It's not that bad over 20 years.
I'm not speaking of your phase, Jean-Claude. I'm speaking of today. Today, the inflation rate is stuck at 1%. Inflation rate is stuck at 1%. The Fed is at 2% and rising. The ECB is 1% and not rising.
Ashoka, there is some kind of consensus now, including the IMF, that we are not absurd in projecting 1.7 for next year and 1.7 for the year afterwards, which is more or less in line with
price stability. It's been predicted for the last 5 years.
Yeah, I mean, okay. Of course. But we were in the worst crisis ever since World War II. And it started in Wall Street. So to put the blame on the euro area is a little bit overdone.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt. Olivier, you also you recently published a piece on Italy, giving your assessment of the fiscal policy of the current coalition. So that would be a good point to start with. I mean, give us your take.
So I'll make 2 points. The first one is this piece that you referred to, which came out yesterday, which argues that the fiscal expansion that Italy is embarking on may actually not affect growth positively at all. The reason is, when you have a fiscal expansion, you're going to get an increase in interest rates. In normal countries, the central bank is going to react. But when you are in a country where the investors, the foreign investors, the domestic investors are on the edge, what you're going to get is a spread. And basically, the increase in the spread that the government and the budget has created, which is about 250 points, is probably sufficient to offset any direct effect. So my sense is that the forecast of growth for Italy are wrong, and this has implications, because if they don't deliver on growth and they have a larger deficit in the end, then things will look bad. Now, the other point that I want to make is that there's a more fundamental point, which is, it's a point I made yesterday briefly, but I'll make it again, which is, if you have, in any of the euro countries, a populist government which is not willing to play by the fiscal rules at all, so which appears to be fiscally responsible, or makes noises about maybe there's a plan B if we get out of the euro, it is a recipe for foreign investors to take their money, move out, for domestic investors to take their money, move out. What is the amount of money which can in principle move just from the foreign investors? It's more than 2 trillion. There is absolutely no way anybody can stand in the way of a stampede, in which case, in this case, the banks have to close, there's a banking holiday, and they have to reopen with the lira. And that scenario, I think, unfortunately, has positive probability. And I think it's going to be an existential issue for the euro, because the probability that there is a populist government somewhere in the euro in the next 10 years is fairly high. And that tension is going to be there. It's very hard to see how it gets resolved. The euro is incompatible with at least some forms of populism.
I would add just one caveat to what you just said, because you sort of can be understood as saying we have no instrument. There is an instrument at the OMT of the ECB, but it supposes that there is a program a policy program that's agreed upon between the ESM and the government, which is obviously the solution to the political equations you're putting.
If we see a Tsipras again, which is somebody changing his mind, realizing that the environment is not very nice, then the crisis can be solved. But if the government insists keeping the same line, there is no OMT, there is no program,
we agree on that.
And it doesn't happen.
Reactions to this point? Yeah, Jean-Claude?
Yeah, again, I think that any time we have a problem, we are back to the existential problem of the euro, of the euro area. I think it's wrong. And I think that we proved over the last 20 years that this permanent assumption that we are on the verge to catastrophe is not right. We had the stress test. We passed the stress test. The situation of Italy today is much, much better, obviously, than the situation of Greece. And even in Greece, the people didn't want to leave. As I already mentioned, the Italian people doesn't want to leave. The Prime Minister, the President of the Council of Ministers in Italy, and the two leaders of the two other parties had said publicly, we don't want to leave the euro, we don't want to leave the European Union. So I think there is a triangle, the market, investors and savers the world over, and nationally, of course, the government, and the promise they made, and the Commission, and the partners. The Commission is simplification for all the other partners in Europe. And my bet, which I'm very confident on the result, would be that a solution would be found out. And of course, the markets, if there is the confirmation that Italy doesn't want to do anything that would re-establish creditworthiness, I experienced that myself in August 11. And it was so dramatic that we intervened overnight on the market massively. It was the SMP program. We didn't let the speculation to explode. I wrote a letter to Berlusconi in explaining Berlusconi that in my mind and the mind of Mario, because there was the double signature of the ECB and of the national governor, we thought the situation was so dramatic that the government had to give a number of new signals to the overall investors and savers the world over. And it was done. And of course, there were changes of government and so forth. So I am absolutely confident on the fact that we will surmount the difficulty. The political difficulty, I fully agree, is extremely worrying, not only for Italy, but for others, because when extreme left and extreme right are uniting, it is the worst possible political situation you can have. We had the experience of the 30s, between the two world wars. So I take very, very seriously the political aspect. I would not say that it means that the euro area will explode.
I want to be clear that I'm not saying it will happen. I'm on the same side as you. If I had to take a bet, I would bet against, but I think the probability is sufficiently high that we have to think about it.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, if I don't open the floor now, that will be a joke. So let me open the floor. I see three hands here. On the first row, can you have a mic? Est-ce qu'on peut apporter un micro là, la première rang?
Thanks very much. I have a rather simple question. As a Canadian living in a federation with probably as much decentralization amongst the provinces, who can run their own deficits without control from the federal government.
Sorry, we don't hear you very well.
Is it on? Is it on?
Yeah, better.
No, I'm saying I'm from Canada. We have a federal government, of which I was a member and a minister for some years. The provinces have enormous independence, fiscal, they have independence. They basically have huge disparities. Newfoundland, for example, would suffer enormously when Ontario was doing well because basically they had to sell at an elevated dollar, which has fluctuated from above the American to below the American and so on, fluctuates all the time. Now, my question is why Why is that working so well in Canada? What are we doing? Is it transfer payments? Is it equalization payments? What's the difference?
We got it. Thank you. We will answer this question.
A simple
comparison
question.
With Canada. Yes, and I'll take then one question here and then the lady over there.
Yeah, Ouida Douche with OCP Policy Center and Google. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I must say that I sympathize a lot with Ashoka's point of view. The idea that, you know, because people don't want to leave, that's a kind of justification. It's like saying, well, you're in the top floor of a building and the house is on fire, you don't want to jump out. So that's the analogy that I would use.
And the question?
Because, yeah, the question I have is, and it's in the other direction, is it possible that it's going to get easier now with the euro? Because the creation of the euro created a lot of imbalances because of the convergence of interest rates, which turned out to be a mistake on the part of the financial markets.
Thank you. Madam?
Yes, I have a direct question. If Italy goes through a financial crisis, will the answer of the European Union be a bailout? Thank you.
Will it be a bailout? Will the EU bail out Italy?
Yeah. Will the European Union bail Italy out?
Yeah.
Okay. Monsieur, et ensuite on revient aux panélistes.
Oui, merci beaucoup. Nous avons vu que l'unilatéralisme, les sanctions américaines et des problèmes de guerre commerciale sont en train de faire pression sur les banques, et notamment en ce qui concerne l'usage du dollar dans le commerce international. Il y a actuellement donc une réflexion pour voir comment peut-on résoudre ce problème et le contourner. Est-ce que l'euro en tant que monnaie peut répondre à la question et dans quelle mesure?
Merci d'ajouter cette dimension. Perhaps in reverse order, Olivier?
No, start with Jean-Claude.
You start with Jean-Claude, okay.
I missed the last question, I'm sorry.
The last question was, est-ce que nous pouvons utiliser, est-ce que l'euro a un potentiel pour être une monnaie internationale et pour répondre aux pressions américaines sur l'utilisation du dollar dans le cadre des sanctions contre l'Iran?
Clear enough. Je peux peut-être répondre alors à la dernière question d'abord et puis ensuite aux autres. Euro, monnaie qui a démontré sa crédibilité, représente au moment où je parle 22% de l'international debt outstanding, de la totalité de la dette mondiale, trois fois moins que le dollar approximativement, huit fois plus que le yen, donc c'est la seconde monnaie entre les deux autres, mais plus proche du dollar que du yen. En ce qui concerne les réserves de change, c'est à peu près la même proportion. En ce qui concerne les monnaies de paiement, à ma surprise d'ailleurs, l'euro représente 31% mondialement et le dollar 42%. Donc on a une vraie existence de l'euro, mais je ne crois pas qu'il faille l'interpréter comme permettant de bypasser le dollar des États-Unis personnellement, parce que toutes les entités internationales ont besoin d'avoir une activité aussi libre que possible aux États-Unis. Ce n'est pas simplement la question du règlement en dollars sur New York, c'est aussi la question de l'ensemble des intérêts que les uns et les autres ont aux États-Unis. Et donc, je ne crois pas que nous soyons dans une situation, malheureusement à certains égards, nous permettant réellement de nous libérer du dollar des États-Unis à partir du moment où le Congrès américain, l'exécutif américain et l'opinion publique américaine considèrent que c'est absolument normal d'utiliser tous les moyens de pression qu'ils peuvent avoir.
Jean-Claude, sur ce point, je suis tout à fait d'accord avec ça, mais j'ai quand même une question précise. Une grande différence, c'est que l'utilisation du dollar comme monnaie internationale est favorisée par le fait qu'en situation de stress, il y a la possibilité d'avoir l'accès à la liquidité en dollars via les lignes de swap de la Fed. Les lignes de swap de la Fed sont un instrument de diplomatie internationale et il y a un soutien du Trésor. Ce n'est pas une politique autonome de la Fed, c'est un élément de la politique extérieure des États-Unis. L'Europe n'a pas fait ça. Est-ce qu'il est concevable que demain, on puisse avoir une ligne de swap en euros avec, évidemment, l'assurance pour la BCE qu'en cas de perte, ce serait compensé par les autorités budgétaires européennes.
Le réseau mondial de swap que nous avons est parfaitement symétrique. Si il y avait un manque de liquidité euro, on pourrait obtenir de l'euro en allant aux États-Unis.
Personne ne pense que ça servira dans ce sens-là. La question, c'est est-ce qu'un pays tiers, le Maroc demain, ou un autre qui demanderait d'avoir une ligne de swap en euros, est-ce qu'il pourrait l'obtenir avec le risque que ça représente pour la zone euro?
Les banques centrales qui sont dans le réseau de swap, qui devra d'ailleurs être réactivé le cas échéant, et étendu évidemment. Normalement, par ce réseau, on a accès à toutes les grandes monnaies convertibles mondiales en présentant du collatéral dans sa propre monnaie. Ce réseau. Pour le moment, il est symétrique, légalement. Bien entendu, de facto, le dollar est beaucoup plus utilisé que les autres monnaies. Mais comme je l'ai dit, ce n'est pas simplement un problème de monnaie. C'est aussi un problème de mesures de rétorsion prises aux États-Unis contre les intérêts étrangers aux États-Unis. Quand je discute avec des banques européennes, elles me disent « on ne veut pas prendre le risque d'avoir un règlement qui serait en euros et totalement indépendant du dollar, parce que de toute manière, nos intérêts aux États-Unis même seront mis en cause ». Donc il faut voir l'étendue du problème. Bien entendu, au fur et à mesure, nous prendrons une dimension supérieure. Il faut aussi noter que nous n'avons pas intérêt, nous, Européens, pour le moment, à avoir un euro beaucoup plus utilisé qu'il ne l'est actuellement, parce que ça se retrouvera sur le marché d'échange et on aurait un « picking up of the euro » qui serait peut-être très, très dangereux pour nous à terme. Donc, je crois que nous sommes dans une période de transition qui est nécessairement ordonnée. Elle est rendue plus difficile par un certain « inward looking » des États-Unis eux-mêmes, dont ils ne se rendent pas compte d'ailleurs. Ils sont dans leur propre système, ils ne se rendent pas trop compte. Si je peux très très rapidement aller aux autres pays, même au Canada, il me semble, les différents États sont récompensés plus ou moins par l'image qu'ils donnent, par les mesures qu'ils peuvent prendre. Et j'ai vu moi-même, de mes propres yeux, la montée en puissance de certaines villes, et la dégradation, Toronto par exemple versus Montréal. J'ai vu à quoi ressemblait, si vous voulez, une image plutôt plus négative donnée d'un État particulier, d'une province particulière par rapport aux autres. Donc je crois que même dans une fédération aussi perfectionnée que la fédération canadienne, on a encore des phénomènes de ce genre. Et bon, qu'il y ait une certaine punition pour des mesures qui ne sont pas optimales, en tout cas vu du point de vue des opérateurs de marché, des investisseurs et des épargnants, c'est compréhensible. Je le déplore, mais c'est compréhensible.
Peut-être qu'il vaut mieux laisser les autres questions aux autres intervenants de manière à terminer à peu près dans les temps.
Très, très volontiers.
You want me to go?
Yeah.
Okay. So, in response to the questions, I'll make three very quick points. Number one, the fundamental sin of the euro continues to be a monetary union that is not backed by a political contract that has a political union. That was Calder's point, that was Marjolaine's point, and both of them said that there never will be. Therefore, Canada has a political contract, the European Union will never have one. As a consequence, rules will never work. Rules will not work because the national interests will always, at critical moments, override the rules. Therefore, the idea that we will construct something that has the look and feel of a political union without actually creating a political union, for example, reference has been made a number of times to something called the banking union. Completion of the banking union. Ultimately, a banking union is a fiscal union. In the United States, there is a banking union because there's an entity called the Federal Deposit and Insurance Corporation that is backed by the full faith and credit of the US sovereign. There will never be in Europe anything that has anything remotely like the FDIC. And as long as there's no FDIC, calling it a banking union is always going to be a misnomer. And so if there is a crisis, the ability to bail out may be quite along the lines that Olivia is saying. But remember, and the in the book called Collapse by Jared Diamond, I'm going to end with this, he uses the analogy of how societies collapse. They don't collapse in a day. They collapse, he gives the analogy of deforestation. The forest declines over time, but saplings grow back. And you look at the saplings and say, well, things are improving. But over time, the saplings cannot recover the deforestation process. The Greek story is not a good story to tell. The fact that Tsipras agreed to the terms that were dictated by the Brussels and Berlin has created, in the end, a deep animosity within Greece. It may for the next two generations, the Greek Parliament will not be able to take any fiscal decision that is not authorized by Brussels and or Berlin and Frankfurt.
And the IMF.
The IMF is out of the picture. IMF. So while it may appear as though the Greek problem is solved, but it remains festering at a deeper level, which at some point will reveal itself.
Thank you. Olivier, it's been flashing red for some time, but nevertheless, we've got to answer the question by the lady over there.
So, I should take one. First, the answer on why is it that it's working in Canada or the US? There's what Jean-Claude said. I think there are other reasons. Labor mobility across states or across provinces in Canada. Federal transfers, which are much larger there. And the absence of banking fiscal loops, which is a big issue in Europe, is not in those countries. On the bailout, I'm quite sure that the euro would try very hard not to bail out Italy, unless they did penance and were willing to do something in exchange. But it would be a terrible legal mess, as we well know, because there would be redenomination of many liabilities in liras, and lawyers would have a field day, and God knows how it ends, is basically the way to say it.
Okay, thank you very much. The difference between Salvini and me, that has been flashing red for a while, I do apologize.